The year is 1878. Ornithologist Ludwig Kumlein is in the North Atlantic with Inuit hunters. As he rides the bow of a small boat, not far away, a flock of shorebirds flies high over the water. They spy a whale resting on the surface and head for it. One of the hunters raises a shotgun and shoots. After the whale dives, Kumlein picks up a bird from the surface. Its esophagus is crammed with tasty parasites picked from the whale's back. For 10 months of the year, such is the life of a red phalarope, a dull gray and white sandpiper that lives mostly at sea. But in mid-May, they come ashore. Like magic, the females have become a brilliant carmine red. The males are paler. It happens in the high Arctic, and to see it, you must go there. Unlike other birds, female phalaropes have the color, and males tend the nest. Unlike shorebirds, as we southerners are used to seeing them, on the breeding ground, red phalaropes have little fear of humans, sharing their most intimate moments. The babies grow quickly on a diet of tundra insects, and those who don't succumb to Jaegers, or Arctic foxes, retire to the sea. The adults leave even before the young, and by the beginning of July, they're losing those wondrous hues that bring birders to such high latitudes. As for me, a city kid living in a dingy town, it was this page in an old field guide that began a quest after birds, hoping someday to see all of these in real life. Once, it was a red-necked phalarope. Then for a while, northern phalarope. Now, it's red-necked again. Whatever you call it, it's the smallest of the three species, and probably the shyest, always keeping a few reeds between itself and the camera. You can see how the red neck offers camouflage among these stems of mare's tail. Here's the male. Dull as he is, he still gets what he wants. Then he goes off to build a nest in the grass of the tundra. These birds also spend winters at sea. They often come inland, and migrating individuals are always a treat in whatever pond, puddle, or water treatment facility they stop at. Even though, by the time that happens, they too are just gray and white. Here is our land phalarope, as it rarely goes to sea. It's Wilson's phalarope. On a gray and rainy day, the beautiful colors are muted. But let her see the sun, and she drips with color. In Audubon's day, they nested as far east as New Jersey. But today, they're basically western birds, common on the plains to the Rockies. They're social birds and form large flocks where they dip and poke and spin. While on land, you can see an adaptation for swimming in these shorebirds. The legs are compressed. Look how they are nice and sturdy, viewed from the side, but thin, seen from the front. Audubon said the legs come to a point at the rear, perfect streamlining for moving through water. Like the other two, Wilson's phalaropes are in splendid dress for only a month or two, then quickly change to a gray-brown. That the female phalarope was the eye-catching one, was known to Danish ornithologist Frederick Faber in 1821. 15 years later, Audubon got it backwards. Here is Audubon's painting of Wilson's phalarope. He called bird number one a male and number two a female. He made the same mistake with his red phalaropes. By the 1870s, most experts had figured it out. In 1876, the same Ludwig Kumlein who began this little story explained it in a popular magazine. And soon after, it became common knowledge that those aggressive and colorful ones were the females. The native peoples of the North certainly knew the females. They saw the unlaid eggs as they cleaned and ate phalaropes for thousands of years. As one British hunter put it,
"They make capital pies."